So this is the entire story of how I win, where my subscribers voted for me to go. I set up a poll every day where everybody could vote me either south, east, north or west, and I'd move 20 meters in that direction. By the way, that's about this much. As I was vaccinated now and Europe finally began opening again after more than a year without travel, I was truly excited to get out into the world. The only problem was I wasn't really sure where to go. I was certain though that the community around this channel would be able to choose a great adventure for me. It worked like this. I wrote a Python script that would take the results of the poll in real time and then generate a map and put it on a stream so everybody could see the current results. I also built an app for my phone that tracked my GPS coordinates all the time so you could see how close I was. Yeah, I know it looks terrible. It's my first app ever. Luckily, I also got Morten to go with me, at least for the first week, since I need him back on his job after that. We had no idea where we were going or what to expect, but we were both very excited. Though also a bit nervous to post the first poll and explanation video.
I left my basal planet in the care of my girlfriend.
It was awesome to finally start and get out on the road. The project seemed way more popular than I anticipated. Just on the first day, more than 60,000 people voted, and the results were very quickly heading southeast. So we drove towards the ferry to Germany. A 40-minute ferry ride took us across the water. From the ferry you could see the construction of the new Fehmarn tunnel being built to connect Denmark to Germany. We also had time to pretend we were riding motorcycles and just gaze out over the water. Not too far into Germany, we hit a big traffic jam on the Autobahn. Staying still while our destination got further and further away felt a bit frustrating, but luckily we had a good playlist with German music to pass the time. At some point a Polish YouTuber named Graf found my stream and set up his own stream. He has 330,000 followers and he began asking them to vote to get us to drive to Poland. They even figured out by changing their votes that they could draw on the map, so he organized an attempt to write Bro, where his followers were voting depending on the first letter in the name. Which forced me to change the code a bit here on the passenger side to avoid this again in the future. I got to respect the effort and creativity from him and his army though. Anyway, the results seemed very clear. We were going to Poland. A bit before the German city of Rostock, we stopped briefly on a fancy restaurant to have some Michelin star quality German food. The famous Bockwurst. We were very lucky to get one of the last tables, where we enjoyed this fine dining experience. And then was back on the road. Driving through the northeastern section of Germany, we saw all the windmills with their red lights in the night. They looked like something evil from a sci-fi movie, but pretty cool though. We were thrilled to cross into Poland. The very first thing we did was drive straight to the city of Stettin, where we found a hotel for the night. The next morning I set up a small studio to record the first video update from the trip, and then we went out to see the city and just walk around. A little tip, if you ever find yourself eating breakfast in Stettin, don't ask the waiter for a cup for your tea or they'll just laugh at you. In Stettin you just lift the teapot to find it. Anyway, we got going after breakfast. The people voted we should go south, so that's what we did. We made a small detour though to see what is apparently the biggest Jesus statue in the world. Yep, it should be even bigger than the one in Brazil. Please fact check me on this. It even distributes free Wi-Fi. After Jesus, we went back to the Polish highway, with a beautiful flat landscape, towards Poznan.
Poznan!
Though we actually never entered Poznan. At a parking space in front of a supermarket, we bought some bananas and bread and cheese and watched the premiere of the second video in the series on the computer on the roof of the car.
It was awesome to start and get out on the road.
After the premiere, we continued again. We decided to spend the rest of the day in Wrocław, which is a beautiful historical city with a cool young atmosphere. The old town square is filled with narrow, colorful houses. And by my estimation, here are probably more churches than people. Since it was a very warm day, Morten bought us some squared ice creams. Luckily, in this city, it's no problem if you get it on your hands, since they built plenty of places to wash your hands for ice cream. Kuba reached out to me on my Instagram, so we went out to get some Polish food in the form of pierogi. And he brought his roommate Veronica. As they were both architects, they took us around the city and showed us all the cool stuff. Cooper took us to the Neon Side Gallery and agreed to explain it to the channel, but while editing, I just noted that there was copyrighted music playing in the background. So I'm terribly sorry, but the audio can't be played. I promise it was very interesting what he was saying though. We also saw this large chair, Morten for scale. If you ever have trouble with the Polish parking system, the kind Poles will always help you. I noticed a few attempts from different countries to get us to go there. The Czechs actually succeeded in pulling our destination into the Czech Republic very briefly, but the Poles pulled it right back into Poland. For the past days, the Polish people have ganged up and forced us to go to the city of Sosnowiec, so we did that. It must be a very popular city, since thousands of people voted for us to go there. We were pretty excited about it.
Sosnowiec! Sosnowiec!
It seems you need a passport to enter.
Obviously, a lot of people must want to live here, since they build a lot of these big, beautiful apartment buildings to house everybody. The city features this little market, where you can get some fresh green stuff, or even a Polish flag for your car. By the way, it looks pretty cool in the wind, right? You can also get some Georgian food there, but careful, it's hot. They also have the most sharp and pointy thermometer I have ever seen. The camping wagons there are compact, and they have this system for spraying water out to cool people down on hot days. If you need a coffee, there's this little cafe. Since people from all over Poland want to go there, it's obviously well connected by trains to the rest of the country. If your legs get tired there, no problem. Some of the steps are actually even automated. What a place. If you are wishing that you could live there, but thinking it's impossible, I have great news for you. There's actually a lot of apartments available for some reason. To be fair, a lot hit me up in my DM on Instagram and called it Poland's meme city. Even people who lived there. So, some people might have sent us there as a joke, but we really had a fun day anyway. I can even see myself retiring here after YouTube. Afterwards, the boat headed south to Slovakia, so we got back on the road. We were told we had to see the statue, but we had never read or seen Bolek and Lolek before, so the meaning might have been a bit lost to us. From the car windows, the landscape looked amazing as we drove towards the mountains. I would like to thank everybody who voted to take us through there. As we entered Slovakia, the vote had already ended up in Hungary though. We had heard that it was unfortunately impossible to enter Hungary due to restrictions, and that we would have to drive around it. Anyway, after all the driving, sometimes it's good to get out and stretch your legs. The Slovak landscape looked way too beautiful, especially on the top of the many bridges we drove over. It was sort of a cat and mouse game, and it felt really strange not knowing where we were going, but it was also a lot of fun. Especially with all the support we received, so thank you to everybody who participated. We were pretty entertained by reading the memes about the trip in the Spaghetti Road subreddit. We found a hotel in the Slovak countryside, where we stayed for the night. We discussed whether or not this cat was the owner. Before we could get going in the morning, we learned that there should be an old castle from the 13th century, which we wanted to hike up and see. But when we got up there, none of us had brought money for the entrance fee, so we had to head back. The guys dressed in medieval attire were nice though. They were practicing their whipping skills in front of the castle. We shopped for some food and drinks in the supermarket and wanted to buy a small flag for the car, but they only had this one. I think it might be a bit too big. We did some driving in Slovakia and then took a small break in the shade, so I could release the next video. If anybody's wondering about the process, whenever something looks fun or interesting, we just pull up our camera and record a small clip. Then in the evening when we arrive, I try to write a script and organize the footage before bedtime. In the morning before we go anywhere, I record myself speaking and finally edit the videos on the passenger seat before noon while we're driving. So I apologize if the quality isn't amazing, I have to cut a few corners to be able to make it. There's quite a bit of work. Anyway, it's fun. We had learned that we could legally transit straight through Hungary. We wanted to stay a bit and a lot of people actually reached out on my Instagram and offered to show us around, but unfortunately due to restrictions we are only allowed to transit the country. In Hungary you also need a vignette, which you can get online. And we found it pretty funny that if you're coming with a Danish car, you have to select Greenland. The vote was either taking us to Serbia or Croatia, but it wasn't clear which one it was yet. It was almost right in the middle. The Hungarian roads were empty, in a good condition and with a great view. But next time I'd like to see more of Hungary than what we could see from our car windows. The sun was shining all day and was quite hot. While I was driving, I had some fun by turning Morten's seat heating on whenever he was looking away. The boat had settled in Croatia, and after speedrunning Hungary in just a few hours, we crossed the border. The Croatian roads in the east were even more empty, and with a lot of farming landscape. We again got a small flag, which we mounted to the car before we found a place to stay in Osijek. The city has this big stadium, and the people we met so far were friendly. At the hotel, I noticed what a fashionable guy Morten is with his t-shirt. A quick plug, it's available at spaghettiroad.com. As we got going in the morning, the pool said we should head west. We didn't take the highways, but opted for the more scenic routes, though it was a lot more time consuming. We got to Virovitsa. If you ever go, there's this big pink castle. Getting phone reception was pretty hard, so we had some trouble uploading the video of the day. We found a small cafe with Wi-Fi, which turned out to be even worse, but after a bit of struggle, we got it out in the end, and we could get back to driving. The pull was taking us to the Croatian coast, and it was going through Bosnia and Herzegovina. It would actually be quite a bit faster to just stick to the Croatian highways around it, but we are not cheaters, so we drove south to the Bosnian border. Right before the border we stopped and got some ćevapi, since a couple of Croats DM'd me and said we should try it. Crossing the border was fairly quick, but there was a long queue to exit Bosnia and Herzegovina, so we were a bit nervous about how difficult it would be to get out again. Anyway, we were in the Serbska Republic in Bosnia and Herzegovina.
We drove on an incredible road adjacent to a beautiful river, which we had to stop and enjoy a few times. Later, the terrain became a lot more mountainous as the road went through some sort of canyon. We both realized that the road would take us past Plevice National Park. Here's the very brief backstory if you didn't see my Driving to China series. So, Morten wanted to see this park, and we were going there a few years ago. Very close to the park, our car broke down, but luckily a kind man let us sleep in his backyard while our car was getting fixed. After a few days, we got the car back, but we had to give up on seeing the park due to time, so we actually never saw it. Anyway, I seen the Spaghetti Road subreddit and in the comments here that a lot of people are fighting to get us to Plevice, so a sincere and huge thank you. Before we could go to the park, there was one thing we needed to do though. First, we had to find and thank our old host in Bosnia who helped us. As we found his house again, he was sitting outside in his front garden. We showed up completely unannounced after years, but he recognized us immediately. It was incredible to meet again. He had actually already seen the Driving to China series. We were really happy to see him again. We even had to FaceTime Ty, who had no idea, so he could say hello as well. We brought him a bottle of vodka, which we got in Poland, and he gave us a couple of ice creams. Still a great guy. After our visit, we drove towards the border. Luckily, there was only about half an hour of queue. Some people noted that the stream had some issues, so I was trying to fix it while we waited for the border checks. We found a place on the creation side of the border and got some much needed sleep before we got going in the morning.
Whoa, desperate pizza!
I'm sorry, I don't think we have time.
And we drove right past it immediately. No, that's of course just a joke. There was no way we were not gonna go there. The water was really blue and you had an amazing view. There were quite a few people, even though we tried to arrive early. It felt awesome finally going there after all these years. I recommend the place. The destination from the pool went straight over the Adriatic Sea from Croatia to Italy. Since our car only drives on land, we planned to take a ferry, but when we began researching it, we couldn't find any ferries for the day. Impatient as we were, we opted for just driving around it. At first, we thought we could make it in no time. Once we got to the Croatian highways, we were making some serious distance. We quickly crossed into Slovenia, and I asked here if anybody have some interesting facts about Slovenia. I didn't fact check anything myself, so please do. Apparently they're the authors of the oldest script written in the Slavic language. They have the oldest vine that still produces grapes. For some reason they have the most tractors per capita, and they have Europe's third shortest coastline. It seems if you're neighboring Croatia, you shouldn't expect to get a lot of coastline. I'd love to see more again someday, but in just about 30 minutes we were out again and into Italy. We were both very excited to be in Italy. I got to admit, we actually felt the Italian driving style was a bit harsher than what we had seen on the rest of the trip. A lot of people said we should go to Venice, so we went there as it was on the way anyway. We actually had both been there before, but this was probably the best time ever to visit, since there was almost no tourists compared to normally. This city is amazing. I guess everybody knows it, but the streets in Venice are canals, so you see these small gondolas instead of cars. The place is truly one of a kind. We decided that our first meal in Italy should be pizza. There was this dog sitting on a balcony above us as we ate. The pizza was pretty good. But we noticed that the dog had certainly turned a lot smaller. Or maybe the owner just had two different dogs. We headed down south to towards where the result of the pull was, but it was getting a bit late, so we found a hotel for the night, where they really like Ferraris apparently. It seems that it takes a long time to drive around the sea. There might be a reason people are using the ferries after all. A lot of people said we should go to San Marino, so we drove a couple of hours south towards San Marino. Here's a quick tip for anybody if you're ever doing a road trip where people can vote where you go and you need to upload a video to YouTube. Then the Italian malls have excellent Wi-Fi just for that. Anyway, we made it to the country of San Marino. I think the people wanted to make it as difficult as possible to make pictures with their country sign, since they put it up so high. But that couldn't stop an experienced climber like me. There was something special about finally being in this small country of just about 30,000 people. It's pretty cool that this small place plays football against other countries and is represented in the UN. I heard somebody joke about competing in the Eurovision is almost like jury duty with so few people living here. We drove up the mountain and made use of the convenient cable car, which gives you a great view while you take it up to the old fortress looking part of the city. There was a Christmas store, a lot of tax-free stuff, and then weapons. Apparently San Marino have the most relaxed gun laws in Europe. On the very top of the hill you can see this fortress, it's pretty cool. From there you can view the entire country of San Marino and even far into Italy. Their flag is so we had to buy one. By the way, she gave me San Marino euros back. In case you need to pray or just want to see a church, there's a great one there. There were some issues with the stream again, but luckily San Marino have the perfect spot to fix it, while you can enjoy an ice cream there.
Even though the country is small, they have nature, cultivated fields, and yeah, they just have space, actually. After our time in San Marino, we drove towards Bologna, where I would drop Morten off since he had just bought a flight back. It was pretty last minute that he even decided to go on the trip, so unfortunately he couldn't get more time off from work. He is honestly the best road trip companion I could imagine. Sitting in the car alone afterwards felt pretty weird. The pool suddenly began heading north, so it seemed like I wouldn't get to see Monaco after all. I stopped and did my first live Q&A ever on Instagram at SpaghettiRoadOfficial. It was really a lot of fun talking to everybody, and yeah, everybody was just so nice, so I'll certainly do it again. I found a small room in Parma where I would stay for the night. While waiting, I met Pascal and we ended up talking during the night.
Hello people, it's me Pascal. I'm here with my good friend. Keep supporting him, follow him. He's a good man. Take care. I love you from Italy. Bye.
He is my first candidate for Morten's replacement now. There were a lot of queue on the highway, so I stood still for quite some time. Milan was on my way northwest, and as I had never been there before, it'd be crazy not to stop. Federico reached out to me on Instagram and offered to show me around. We saw the Milan Cathedral, which is largest in Italy since the Vatican is independent. It's actually also the third biggest in the entire world. Federico was a great tour guide while we walked around the city. He can probably explain stuff better than me.
That arch is Victor Emmanuel II's arch, which is a gift that the people of Milan gave to Victor Emmanuel II. Victor Emmanuel II was the king of Sardinia who unified Italy. While there, that is basically owned by Berlusconi, the whole thing. And basically there's his library there, but like the whole thing is owned by him.
He showed me the opera and these ruins. Since Milan is world famous when it comes to fashion, you see a lot of the high-end brands there, though there was no store with the SpaghettiRoad.com t-shirts for some reason. Federico had been very dedicated to voting us around and getting me here.
Team West. Although yesterday I betrayed you for North.
Since Morten was gone and it's dangerous to operate your phone while driving, I had to find a way to film from the car. I bought this mechanical replacement for Morten for just $16.95, so hopefully I can get some cool driving shots, even though I'm alone now. There's one thing I don't get about Italy. Most people I spoke with were really nice and friendly, but once I met people in traffic, a lot seemed quite aggressive. Like everybody's in some sort of competition. The only place on the trip where we experienced any traffic like this was in Italy. Overall, my conclusion is that Italians outside of their cars are amazing people. The vote was going through Geneva and Switzerland, so I headed to the Alpine part of Italy. It had a very different and calm atmosphere compared to what we'd seen before. It was really beautiful with all the mountains in the background. After driving through a lot of tunnels, I made it to the final bus, the Mont Blanc tunnel. As soon as I got out of the French side, it began raining heavily, so I can conclude that France is probably a very rainy country. I decided to stay here in Chamonix, so I'd be able to see Mont Blanc in the morning. So far I've been trying to travel for as little money as possible, but for dinner I found a bit of a fancy looking restaurant where I got a seat with a view right into the kitchen. They gave me this very tall beer, some incredible fried shrimp, and a portion of beef tartare. It was an amazing meal. Though with the tunnel pass, tickets for the lift, my meal and hotel, I had probably spent more in my first hour in France than I did in 3 days in Poland. Luckily, if I continue towards Geneve, Switzerland is famous for being a cheap country, right? I'm not too much into football, but when France was playing Portugal in the European Championship, it'd be crazy not to see the match here in France. Can anybody guess which country got a goal here? I woke up very excited since I was going to the mountains. Since it would be freezing up there, I discreetly changed to long underwear in a parking lot. I took a cable car up to see Mont Blanc on the border of France and Italy. It's the highest mountain in Europe, outside of Russia. Already in the lift on the way up there, it looked amazing. I felt pretty under-equipped when I looked at the other people, since they were all with full climbing gear such as ropes and ice axes. It looked incredible up there, though a couple of clouds were covering the very top. Anyway, I was quite happy with the clearness. It's always cool to see snow in the summer, though I thought France was supposed to be a warm country. You can walk through this ice cave to get out to where the most climbers begin their path. Being at just below 4,000 meters, there's a lot less oxygen, so I tried running up and down some stairs a couple of times, and I felt I got much quicker exhausted. There's something I just love about being in the mountains. When I got down, I grabbed a quick lunch before I headed for Geneve. The road took me through a lot of valleys with small towns. It was a very nice drive. As a Danish guy, it was hard not to notice that Savoie were using our flag as well. I guess this is how a Romanian guy would feel if he went to Chad. That day, there were quite a bit of rain in France. I crossed the border into Switzerland,
where, I'm not joking, the weather pretty much got better immediately. I went to see the old town in Geneva, which is really cozy. The old-fashioned houses look wonderful. The rain also crossed the border and it caught up with me. So I got a pancake close to their big cathedral, but the lady didn't accept credit cards. As I had already eaten the pancake, I had to walk out in the rain to find an ATM. Later I drove across the lake, which looks quite pretty. I saw a lot of flags. This UN seems to have a flag collection with even more countries than me. I wanted to go in, but it was closed for the day. Red Cross headquarters is also in Geneva. Overall, I really liked the place. People had begun voting me south again, so I drove back into France. The landscape was magnificent. I kept filming a lot, since every minute I'd look out and realize, this looks great. I stopped for the night, and when I got up and began driving the next morning, I noticed it felt a bit less fun than in the beginning. So I pulled the car over, got my phone up, and began recording this clip.
So I think this is a good place to stop the trip. It's been an incredible amount of fun. I really had a good time. But if I don't stop somewhere, I'll keep going forever. And I think now it's been, 10 days, something like that. Right now I'm here in the south of France, and it's not like I can just fly home. I have to break the car, so that'll be at least a couple of days as well. And I don't want to rush. I've been rushing enough now, I think. Thank you so much to anybody who participated, everybody who voted, everybody who made a comment, made a post on Reddit. Especially thank you to everybody who reached out to me and wanted to meet me. It was incredible how many kind people wanted to show the areas, and unfortunately I didn't have enough time, but thank you. I think I will take the slow path now back through Monaco and then through the Alps. I really like the mountains, and then probably through Germany. There are a couple of places that I don't get to see. Some people are trying to get me to Spain and some to Gibraltar. That's not too bad. I'm actually going in a couple of weeks anyway. I already have my ticket booked, so that should be okay. I don't get to see Sas this time at least, maybe someday in the future. Some people are trying to get me to Ukraine, to Chernobyl, but it's not too bad also. I went there a couple of years ago. This is, by the way, my first time talking to the camera. I have a selfie stick and I'm very self-conscious about walking like this. So I found a deserted road here in France.
On the way back, I went through Nîmes. I just figured, since I was already in the habit of filming stuff, I'd show it here. It's crazy how the Roman littered all around the Mediterranean with all their temples and amphitheaters. Somebody suggested I should make a t-shirt with all the countries we went through. Just on a personal level, I'd like to have one and maybe get one for Morten as well. I just made it available on spaghettiroad.com for limited time if anybody else is interested, but there's no pressure at all. About 3 hours later, I got to Monaco. It's indeed a crazy place. I was really thrilled to be there, though my small car didn't really fit in with the other ones. Apparently money is just lying everywhere, I just found 5 cents on the floor. They're happy about their boats, and from the hill it looks quite beautiful. And then it's even smaller than I imagined. After a bit of walking, I crossed the entire country without even realizing it. I was staying right on the border, so if I would jump out my window, I would end up in France. Before I could continue home the next morning, I drove a bit up to have a better view. Then I continued into Italy, the same route that passed Milan, and again back into Switzerland, where it was amazing driving between the mountains. Per suggestion from a lot of people, I stopped and took a night in Liechtenstein. At this point, it was nice not to have to record everything all the time, so I only made this picture. And for the next day, when I continued, I only have a couple of stories from my Instagram.
So, I think I might be in Austria right now. I'm not really sure. I was crossing the border and there were a lot of Swiss flags, but not saying something about Toll in Austria.
I was indeed suddenly in Austria. I think what happened was that Liechtenstein is in a customs union with Switzerland. So that's maybe why there were so many Swiss flags when I crossed the border. The next step was finding out how much it would cost to drive on the Austrian highways. If it was more than 30 euros, I'd just head back.
Wie viel kostet es ein Vignette von ein Tage?
Ein Tage
sind 10 Tage schon.
10 Tage
und 10 Euro. Okay. Dann möchte ich gerne eine.
By the way, thank you to all the people who voted that my German is improving. Then on to the Austrian highways.
Wow, what a country. So far, Austria is worth all of the 10 euros I paid to drive here. It's incredible. I have one small complaint though. There's some sort of small fly or some kind of beetle or something that keeps biting me. I think somebody should work on that, but otherwise, I'm very impressed by Austria. Very happy to be here.
After a way too short time in Austria, I crossed into Germany. Some people reached out and said I should see the church in Ulm, so I did that. Apparently, it's the world's tallest. It took quite a bit of time to drive through Germany, especially because I kept stopping all the time. I decided to find a hotel before I'd continue back to Denmark the next day.
It was a pretty fun experience getting back to Copenhagen, since there was a lot of partying in the streets due to the European Cup. The basil had grown and was in a good condition. I found it a bit funny that after driving through all the Alps, the first thing I did when I got back to Denmark was to go skiing. They built a ski slope on top of this big garbage burning facility in Copenhagen. Yeah, it smelled a bit weird, and the skiing is really not the same. Anyway, thank you so much to everybody who was a part of this. Maybe next time we'll be in the US? Anyway, thank you.